Good morning, everyone. Let's get our music going this morning, and we will pick up almost finished with Interior Freedom by Father Jacques Philippe. Love praising God with the words of our mother. Can't go wrong with that.
My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and my spirit exalts in God my Savior, for He has looked with mercy on my lowliness.
Joining me this morning or later with a recording. Lord, we just want to know you, to see you, to hear you, to follow you, and to be free. This Tuesday morning, February 9th, 2021. Could it really be? Gosh. So, I've so enjoyed this book. We're almost done. Interior Freedom by Father Jacques Philippe. And we left off on page 125 with spiritual trials. We might even finish today. Let's see how we do. Okay. Let's see where we just left off. This was, don't identify people with the bad that they do or with the good that they do. We are loved and valuable independent of what we do or don't do. And when we do bad, and we all have, that's not our identity. You don't have to wear the scarlet letter. Your identity is beloved daughter and son, if, as the case may be, of the King. So number three, spiritual trials. These considerations shed light on the way God teaches and trains us individually and on the meaning of trials in the spiritual life. The trials are purifications, so frequently referred to by the mystics, are there to destroy whatever is artificial in our character so that our true being may emerge, i.e. what we are to God. The night of the soul could be called a series of impoverishments, sometimes violent ones, that strip believers of all possibility of relying on themselves. These trials are beneficial because they lead us to locate our identity where it truly belongs. I so saw this lived out when my dad was sent to prison. He was stripped of everything. His reputation, his physical freedom, his material prosperity, everything. Even like good health care, it was gone. All he had left. And just family, friends, it was him and Jesus alone in prison. It was such a gift. These trials are beneficial because they lead us to locate our identity where it truly belongs. The experience can be highly painful when someone who loves God goes through a phase without an atom of fervor and even with a profound distaste for spiritual things. That can happen. People do not lose their love for God, for their whole being remains completely oriented toward God, but they lose the feeling of love. The benefit of this trial that it deprives of this trial that it deprives us of any, or should say, is that, I think it's missing a word. The benefit of this trial is that it deprives us of any possibility of relying on the good we can do. God's mercy is all. A priest once told me in confession, when you no longer believe in what you can do for God, continue believing in what God can do for you. Progressively, and in a way that parallels their terrible impoverishment, those who go through such trials while still hoping in the Lord begin to realize the truth of something that up until then was only a pious expression. God loves us in an absolutely unconditional way. By virtue of himself, his mercy, and his infinite tenderness, by virtue of his fatherhood toward us. I am having this vision right now of my friend, late friend, Elise Charbonnet-Angelet, who was so gorgeous, head cheerleader, gorgeous, blonde hair, blue eyes, gorgeous teeth, precious figure, vivacious, fun. And she got cancer. So many of you I know knew Elise and her precious family and husband. And there's a photograph that I saw of her standing at her, looking at herself in the mirror. I mean, she was extraordinarily beautiful. And her hair had just fallen out. All of this gorgeous mane of long blonde hair had fallen out. And she had a scarf over her head. And it was one of those rare moments where she was just totally real, vulnerable, not performing, not on, and just looking at herself in the mirror. And it was this moment of trying to, of just like looking for who she truly was, her real identity in Christ. And she was so beautiful in that photograph. God bless you and keep you and make his face to shine on you. May his angels watch over you. May he be gracious to you and fill you with peace. And Mother Mary, wrap you in her mantle. I love you.
Thank you.
Have a great day. Yeah, there's something so extraordinarily compelling about authenticity, where we're not performing, we just are, and we are loved as we are. Okay. This experience produces a fundamental change in our Christian lives. It is an immense grace. The basis of our relationship to God no longer lies in us, but wholly and exclusively in God. Now we become fully free. When our relationship to God has God's fatherhood as its only foundation, it is safe from all harm. People who've passed through this sort of trial are more than ever in love with God and wish to please him by good works. But the good they do is done purely, freely, and disinterestedly. It does not proceed from a need to create an identity or a thirst for success, nor does it have the hidden motive of wanting a reward. Its source is God, and that's something God has to do in us. He has to strip us of those things. This spiritual conversion, well described by the Egyptian monk Mata el Maskin, or El Maskin, Matthew the Poor, in his work on prayer. When Christians devote themselves to the spiritual combat, to assiduousness in prayer, and to the careful observance of other spiritual practices, they can come to feel that this activity and this assiduousness condition their relationship with God. It seems to them then that it is by reason of their perseverance and fidelity to prayers that they deserve to be loved by God and become his children. But God does not want souls to go astray down that false path, which would in fact separate them for good from God's freely bestowed love. This is the Pharisaical attitude and life with him. So he takes away the energy and assiduousness that threaten them with this loss. That's really interesting. I'm just thinking of the times in my own life when I was so vigilant about daily mass, daily adoration, daily rosary, Angelus, regular confession, all of that. And then I just completely lost. I just didn't want to get up. I didn't want to do it anymore. And it could have been that I was in danger of thinking that this was all me and God, and I was earning God's love and approval. Once God has taken away the abilities that he had offered freely in proof of his love, these souls are left without strength, incapable of performing any spiritual action, and are confronted with the stupefying truth that they resist believing and persist in seeing as highly improbable. God in his fatherhood does not need our prayers and our good works. God doesn't need me to lead the rosary every day. He doesn't need me to do this book study. He can raise up millions of other people to do whatever he wants, when he wants it. Our activity does not define us, nor does it earn God's love. At the beginning, they cling to the idea that God has withdrawn his fatherly care from them after they stopped praying, and that God has abandoned them and neglects them because their works and perseverance were not up to the measure of their love. They try in vain to get up from their prostration and mourning and take up their former activity, but all his resolutions go for nothing. And then little by little, they begin to understand that God's greatness is not to be measured by the yardstick of man's futility, that his eminently superior fatherhood chose to adopt the children of dust because of his infinite tenderness and the immensity of his grace, and not in return for the works of man or our efforts. That our adoption by God is a truth that has its source in God and not in ourselves, a truth that is ever present, that persists in spite of our powerlessness and our sin, in witnessing to God's goodness and his generosity. In this way, their spiritual lukewarmness leads these souls to revise their concept of God fundamentally, and also their evaluation of the spiritual relations between the soul and God. This profoundly modifies their concept of effort and assiduousness in spiritual works. They no longer consider these things as the price of God's love, but as responses to his love and fatherly care. What God does in the souls of certain people, we're back to Father Jacques Philippe now. What God does in the souls of certain people by plunging them into that sort of spiritual lukewarmness is something he would like to do to everyone, though perhaps in a less extraordinary and more gradual way, by means of their sufferings, failure, helplessness, falls of every kind, sickness, depression, psychological and affective weaknesses, even if they are our own fault. There's no great difference between spiritual trials and other trials. God makes use of everything, even the consequences of our sins. He can use your sin to actually make you holier. Because when you repent, when we humble ourselves, we have more merit by virtue of our humility because of the sin of our repentance than before we sinned. Not that we're looking to sin, but we will because we're weak. We do want to avoid it, right? But he makes use of everything. It's consoling to know that we can draw great spiritual profit from a trial with nothing spiritual about it. Number 4, relying on mercy alone. Mature Christians who have truly become children of God are those who have experienced their radical nothingness, their absolute poverty, been reduced to nothing. At the bottom of that nothingness, they have finally discovered the inexpressible tenderness, the absolutely unconditional love of God. Henceforth, their only support and hope, is the boundless mercy of their Father God. For them, the words God speaks to the people of Israel through the prophet Zephaniah have come true. I will leave in the midst of you a people humble and lowly. They shall seek refuge in the name of the Lord. They do all the good they can. They receive what their neighbor may do for them with joy and gratitude, but in great freedom, because their support is in God alone. They are untroubled by their own weaknesses, nor do they blame others for not always meeting their expectations. Reliance on God alone protects them from all disappointment. Wow. Gives them great interior freedom, which they place entirely at the service of God and their fellow men, responding to love with love. Yes. Number 5. The truly free person is the one who has nothing left to lose. That's why people who just abandon everything, who take a vow of poverty, radical poverty, they're so free. The world seeks freedom in the accumulation of possessions and power. True? True. It forgets that the only people who are truly free are those who have nothing left to lose. Despoiled of everything, detached from everything, they're free from all men and all things. It can be truly said that their death is already behind them, because all their treasure is now in God and in Him alone. The people who are supremely free desire nothing and are afraid of nothing. That life of just radical mission is so attractive to me. All the good that matters to them is already guaranteed them by God. They have nothing to lose and nothing to defend. These are the poor in spirit of the Beatitudes, detached, humble, merciful, meek peacemakers. There's a parable expressing this truth in the book by an author with a bit difficult last name, The First Circle, which is set in the era of Stalin's dictatorship. A highly placed party official needs the services of a zec, who is a scientist, for a project he's been put in charge of and on which he is risking his career. He presents all possible arguments to persuade him to collaborate. The author shows perceptively how the really free man in this exchange is not the powerful official, but the prisoner, because he has nothing left to lose. He's ready to go back to Siberia if necessary. Even in those terrible conditions, one can still be a man. Gulags and concentration camps were one of the greatest traumas of the 20th century. Yet they provided abundant cases of people who found true freedom behind bars. This is good news for us. In her book, Etty Hillesum, imprisoned in the camp at Westerbork, reflects, The barbed wire is more a question of attitude. Us behind barbed wire, an indestructible old gentleman once said with a melancholy wave of his hand. They are the ones who live behind barbed wire. And he pointed to the tall villas that stand like sentries on the other side of the fence. Whoa, what a cool attitude of freedom, right? We choose. Are we behind? Who's behind the barbed wire? Us, wire, us or them? She also writes, if you have a rich interior life, I would have said there probably isn't all that much difference between the inside and the outside of a prison camp. Number 6, happy are the poor. As the years go by, I meet people with whom I share things at a deep level and experience the quiet, mysterious, but very real action of God in my life and theirs. More and more, I'm struck by the wisdom in the gospel and by the way the word throws astonishingly accurate light on the human condition. This paradoxical, inexhaustible gospel has unheard of power to humanize us. At the center of the gospel stand the Beatitudes. The first one sums up all the others. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I hope this book has helped the reader to understand this astonishing statement by Jesus and begin to put it into practice. Spiritual poverty, utter dependence on God and his mercy, is the condition for interior freedom. I'm going to say that again. Spiritual poverty, utter dependence on God and his mercy, is a condition for interior freedom. Immaculée Ilibagiza, who was in a bathroom for three months with six other women during the Rwandan genocide, she said she actually longs in some ways for the days when she was stuck in that bathroom, because all she had was God and she was free. We need to become children and consent to expect everything as a gift from God the Father, absolutely everything, moment by moment. We don't know what events will mark the third millennium, but one thing is certain. Those who have learned to discover and expand the inalienable space of freedom that God placed in their hearts by making them his children will never be caught off guard. You will never be caught off guard if we have God as, let me read how he put it again. Those who have learned to discover and expand the inalienable space of freedom interiorly in our souls that God placed in our hearts at our adoption will never be caught off guard. We always have him and the freedom that he alone can give. By way of conclusion, here we go. I love this little book. By way of conclusion, I offer for the reader's meditation a beautiful dialogue between Jesus and a contemporary Spanish spiritual writer who's had a close relationship with Our Lady since childhood and who has chosen to remain anonymous. Have you ever wondered which of all the things you experience causes me the greatest joy? No, I said to Jesus. He answered, when, in lucid freedom, you say yes to God's calls. And then he continued, remember what it says in the gospel, the truth will make you free. You can only respond freely to the calls of grace when your own truth becomes clear, when you accept it humbly, and when, on that basis, you maintain a conversation with God. Realizing that everything has happened and happens to you is part of a loving and providential project of your Father God. Yes, many things will cause you perplexity. They will even plunge you into intense darkness, and still more, into suffering that wounds and paralyzes you. But if you have recourse to your faith, It will be your shield. Doesn't God reveal himself as your Abba? Daddy. Have not I, the Son, taken on your condition at its most wretched? Doesn't the Paraclete defend you? Believe all this with your heart and soul, and it will fill you with trust and confidence. Don't be afraid of yourselves. Don't be afraid of all that you are in your human reality, where God pitches his tent to dwell with you. He pitched your tent right in here. Amazing. God is incarnation. God's new name is Emmanuel, God with us, God with your reality. Open yourself to it without fear. Only in the measure you discover yourself will you discover the depths of his love, your authentic self. In the depths of what you are, you will experience that you are not alone. Someone lovingly and mercifully has entered into the mystery of your humanity, not as spectator, not as judge, but as someone who loves you, who offers himself to you, who espouses you to free you, save you, and heal you, to stay with you forever, loving you. Loving you. The end. Woo! That was good. Oh, I'm going to earmark that one too for rereading. Okay, how good was that? What did y'all think of our book? Did you love it? Don't you feel like you need to go back now and like just start memorizing? I mean, I wanted to read it again because there's so much wisdom in this. Why do we forget? Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the gift of Father Jacques Philippe and the anointing that you have placed on his life to distill truth in such bite-sized little bits. Thank you, Lord. And may we retain all that you want us to learn and remember and pass it on and live the truth that you want to set us free. And that you do set us free. And that you live in us. And that nothing can separate us from your love. And you're not there to judge or condemn or to observe, but to enter in and to love us all the way home to heaven. Amen. Amen. All right, my friends. That did it for us. And so next week, what's today, the 9th? Is it Monday? Today is Tuesday. Yeah, next Monday is February 15th. That is when the consecration to Saint Joseph starts, the book written by Father Don Calloway. So I will not be reading on it. I'm not planning on commenting on it. If that changes, I'll let you know. But I'm really, like, I wrote 10 hours yesterday. I'm really into writing mode right now, writing. And I want to give birth to this baby. So, in fact, it's funny. I flipped open my Bible, which is open on my little altar here. And I had written in the top, I know the Lord is calling me to write a book. That was in 2016. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, God is good and patient with me. So that starts Monday. And then that last 33 days, March 19th, we will consecrate to St. Joseph, or reconsecrate as the case may be. I don't know if I'm going to do anything for that yet. I'll let you know. And then I'm thinking for the book study after that, I'll probably do in the School of the Holy Spirit, because we'll be anticipating Pentecost, which is another book by Father Jacques Philippe. In the School of the Holy Spirit, which I've never read. And I want to be in the School of the Holy Spirit. How about you? All right, I'm going to put a song on, read your comments, and bid you adieu. Adieu, adieu, to you, and you, and you. Okay. Always have The Sound of Music in my head. Because I'm strange that way. All right, let's do a little Be Not Afraid. Yes. God's with us. We have nothing to fear. Really, truly. I want to know what y'all thought of the book. Put it in the comments. God bless all of these people here that I'm reading. Yeah. Elise was so beautiful. Elise, pray for us. But she lived her purgatory. So glad, y'all. This was helpful to you and profound. Standing ovation for Father Jacques Philippe. Today your birthday? Is it Nan Birch? Is that a Nancy? Happy birthday. You're all so welcome. It was a joy to be here. I'm sitting here looking at myself in the eye. So it's like I'm telling myself, like I'm looking in the mirror. This into your brain. So I'm glad y'all are along for the ride. Reminder to Patricia Talbot, Patchy will be at St. Peter in Covington, Louisiana tonight, 6 p.m. Adoration, Holy Hour. The CYO is going to sing during the Holy Hour, and then she'll give her presentation starting at 7, probably about an hour, hour and a half at max. And she will have statues and the rosaries and all that available afterwards. So glad, Charlotte. May God bless you and be with you. This too shall pass. All right, my friends, y'all have a great day. Much love to you. And so I will be back on camera probably in after our consecration to Saint Joseph at some point. But do go ahead and pick up In the School of the Holy Spirit by Father Jacques Philippe and Consecration to Saint Joseph, which you can get at stjosephnow.org, just for a donation and shipping. You can get that book. That starts Monday. All right, have a great day. And I'll be back tomorrow morning with the Rosary, 6 a.m. Central Time. Love to have you join me.